and grab a seat wherever you can. No, please, you're welcome to have us. My name is Eric Owens, and I'm the Associate Director of the Boise Center for Religion and American Public Life, and I teach in the Theology Department here at Boston College. And it is a special pleasure to bring a friend and an expert and a soulful person to come speak about religion, spirituality, and compassionate care tonight. So it is, I'm really, really pleased to be here with Dr. Ron Lackbrook, who I'll introduce in just a second. Before we get going, please turn off the ringers on your cell phones so that they buzz or vibrate and don't chatter while we're going. And I'll let you know also that our conversation is being recorded. And so for those of you who want to watch it over and over again to soak in the wisdom, can do so. Those of you friends and colleagues who wanted to be here but couldn't, will be able to watch it online. It'll probably take us a week or so to get everything trimmed up and posted. It'll be at bc.edu/Boise, B-O-I-S-I. So thank you for that. I want to mention also that the Boise Center has a couple upcoming events that we would love for all of you to attend. One month from today, our visiting scholar, Mara Willard, will give a lunch talk entitled Catholic Afterlives, What Identities and Practices Persist When Catholics Leave the Church. This will be at the Boise Center. We serve a terrific lunch, so if you'd like to join us, you need to RSVP so we can have the proper number of spots. Then, distinguished historian of American religion, Bob Orsi from Northwestern University, will deliver a lecture on Wednesday, April 4th at 5:30 p.m. here in this room, entitled Violence, Memory, and Religion Among Survivors of Clerical Sexual Abuse. The next evening, columnist, author, and professor E.J. Dion will deliver our 17th annual Prophetic Voices lecture entitled Truth and Lies in a Polarized Time. Right now, that's in Gasson 305. That may be expanded if we get a different space that's a little bigger. And then on April 26th, we'll wrap up our events for the semester with a major panel discussion marking the 5th anniversary, which happens in mid-March, actually, of Pope Francis's election, featuring distinguished theologians Lisa Cahill and Nancy Pineda Madrid from here at Boston College, and Massimo Fazioli from Villanova, and Father Brian Hare from Harvard and the Boston Archdiocese. That's at 6:30 p.m. and we've been 121. Hope you'll be there. Tonight's event is sponsored by the Connell School of Nursing. And I want to give a special thank you to Dean Susan Gennaro for making this possible tonight. It's also sponsored by the Medical Humanities, Health and Culture Program at the Morrissey College of Arts and Sciences. Thanks to Amy Boesky for helping make this possible. And of course, it's sponsored by the Boise Center for Religion and American Public Life. I am, again, quite grateful to be here with Dr. Ronald Lackbrook, an internationally renowned medical researcher and physician, to talk about our theme for this evening, religion, spirituality, and compassionate healthcare. Dr. Lackbrook is the director of the Cardiovascular Genetics Clinic and associate in cardiology at Boston Children's Hospital and assistant professor of pediatrics at Harvard Medical School. A leading authority on Marfan syndrome and related connective tissue disorders, he has also been honored for his emphasis on compassionate care, both in his own clinical work and as a mentor and teacher to other healthcare providers. Raised in Hawaii, Dr. Lackbrook earned his MD from Northwestern University Medical School, then completed his internship and residency in pediatrics and a fellowship in dysmorphology and genetics at the University of California Medical Center in San Diego, followed by a fellowship in cardiology at Boston Children's Hospital. In 1991, he founded Children's Hospital's Cardiovascular Genetics Clinic, one of the first of its kind at the time, and now part of the hospital's internationally renowned Heart Center. Since that time, he's led major multi-year NIH-funded studies of Marfan syndrome, published numerous scientific articles, and is a sought-after lecturer on new clinical advances for Marfan patients. In 2014, the Marfan Foundation awarded Dr. Lackbrook its highest honor, the Antoine Marfan Award, in recognition of his outstanding contributions to research and clinical care. And to mention just a couple relevant items about his work in compassionate care, he completed a fellowship in pastoral care for medical professionals in the chaplaincy department at Mass General Hospital during a fellowship year with the Schwartz Center for Compassionate Healthcare. And as a McGovern Scholar in Ethics at Children's Hospital in Boston, he's conducted research on the impact of spirituality and religion on medical decision-making. He's well qualified to have this conversation with us tonight. And on a personal note, I need to say, some of you are aware of my relationship with Ron, and others are not, and I want to say a quick word about that. I came to know Ron a day or two after my son Nicholas was born at Brigham and Women's Hospital on March 3rd, 2009. Nick was born with a severe form of early onset Marfan syndrome that caused rapidly progressing heart, lung, and spinal problems. In his short 3.5 years on this earth, he endured with awe-inspiring grace and courage several life-saving surgeries, dozens of other medical procedures, and the frequent use of ankle braces, spinal braces, supplemental oxygen, and ultimately a BiPAP machine that helped him to breathe. And he passed away at our home on the evening of September 30th, 2012, a little more than 5 years ago. Nick had a strong and joyful spirit, and he loved his doctors, his nurses, his therapists, and other wonderful caregivers, but none more so than Dr. Lacro, who served as his primary caregiver and his medical team leader. So we are bonded together, you and I, and our family forever. And it's not simply because you care for my son at a critical time, but because of the way you care for him, and so many others as well. Combining rigorous, research-driven medicine with deep commitment to compassionate care that recognizes the physical as well as the religious and spiritual needs of your young patients and their parents. So thank you for being here today. We are going to talk with each other for about 30 minutes, and then we'll be turning to the broader room for conversation and questions. Many of you have deep experience in this area as well, and I hope that you'll join us as we open up the conversation in a little bit. So I was hoping we might get started, Ron, by talking about where you came from. You were raised Roman Catholic and born on the island of Hawaii, which has a deep tradition of Buddhist culture as well as indigenous Hawaiian spirituality and religious traditions. So I'm wondering if these sort of, what way these early religious and spiritual traditions have made their way into your decision to be a physician and perhaps a pediatrician.
So I grew up on the Big Island. For those of you who have been to Hawaii, our house was about a half an hour from the active volcano, the Pecos National Park. And it was sort of our backyard on trips. So I mean, I took everything for granted back then. But I grew up in Hawaii as one of 10 children in a Roman Catholic family out in the country. I mean, it was a small town, a little bit over 1,000 people. So everybody knew everyone else. And both of my parents worked. The church was a big part of our lives. And, you know, we went to church every Sunday. I was an altar boy and a church organist as a high school student. And my parents really sort of emphasized education. They were not college graduates, but it was almost understood that we would all go to college, and most of us did or have. Most of my older brothers and sisters went to Catholic universities, and I sort of rebelled and went to Northwestern in Evanston. But I think from very early on, you know, I consider myself, even though I've been in Boston for 30 years, a small town boy, a big family, small town sort of Catholic boy. And that I think really sort of informs a lot of how I approach it. You know, it's all about family and connections to families and stories, and it all started in this town called Na'alehu.
I'll come back to some of the ways that religion and spirituality impacts your daily life today or your practice as a physician, but what was your sort of, how did you come to recognize that working with children as a medical professional or perhaps as a doctor was your path? What was your moment of commitment when you decided that that's where your life would take you?
I don't remember the exact moment, but I remember in medical school just trying to decide whether I was going to be a pediatric cardiac surgeon or a pediatric cardiologist or a pediatric something. I always knew that my work was going to involve being with children and their parents. I didn't really decide to go to into medicine until high school. But during high school and undergraduate, I wasn't really thinking so much about what I would be doing today. But for some reason, maybe because of my background as in a big family, there were always kids younger than me and other neighbors' kids. So it was just sort of a natural, and it was just a matter of trying to decide whether I was going to be operating on a little heart, which I considered for quite some time, or sort of taking care of the medical aspects of heart disease, which is what I do now.
Mm-hmm. How did your training through the many, whatever, 15 years or 20 years of training that it takes to do all the specialties that you do, how did that experience shape you, and how did that relate to we're thinking about the nature of medical care? So we'll talk a little bit also about what compassionate care might mean, but how did your formative experience of being trained in all these different places and disciplines shape your vision of how healthcare ought to be delivered, or how did it connect you with families and children? Did it keep you from them in some way through the structures of the discipline and the practice?
Well, first I want to mention that I was born actually with a heart defect. It was not a major one. I never required surgery, but I was aware of the fact that my heart wasn't completely normal, and here I am, almost 60 years later, taking care of children and families with heart disease. So I think that, again, was a formative sort of experience. Having been to the hospital, undergone procedures, and then back in those days, little kids were not told things. You know, they were doing a catheterization. You know, they used my arm and putting catheters in, and I guess my mom knew what was going on, but they never really thought to tell me what was going on. You know, how long it was going to take, whether I was even going to survive the procedure. It was a very different time. So that informs me clearly, you know, that sort of has helped me approach families, especially children. I've had other experiences as well, and I think maybe the best pathway to compassionate care is to put yourself in the hospital, or be put in the hospital, seriously, because even as an adult, as a patient, you see healthcare in a much very different light. And I think that's perhaps even more than any of the educational experiences that I had, sort of really got me to what it's like to be a patient facing potentially serious illness in the hospital, whether alone or in the context of a family.
How did you learn to talk to patients, to families, and to children? Because for most of us, it's the scariest thing in the world to have that conversation around, especially sending bad news. How did you learn to do that? I mean, I understand that you were a patient too, but was the training appropriate at the time? Have you developed it over years? And how do you understand that first relationship of communicating news?
I mean, I think I've been fortunate to be able to observe other fabulous physicians through the years who sort of do it well, who just by their example. You know, I don't know that it was actually sort of taught intentionally, or maybe they were thinking that way, and I don't even know if I intentionally teach these things. But I think the best way to learn how to have these conversations and have these discussions, even about very serious and potentially fatal conditions. I think observing others who do it well, and I've had the fortune of having to do that. In the best of circumstances, I think having these conversations in some sort of context is helpful. So it's much easier if I have a relationship with a patient or a family that's gone over years. I mean, we worked together for several years, had some very difficult conversations from probably the first day we met. And I think it's sort of trying to find a way to transmit enough information, but not too much, and to over time get to the point where maybe everything can be revealed and understood. I don't think we can do it in a hurry. And And that's one of my worries about how medicine is currently practiced, is that sometimes the time is not, the importance of the time is not recognized or compensated. So that's a completely different subject.
Yeah, sure.
Yeah.
One that I'm sure we'll get to as well. Does one get better at it, or is it always something new and contextual that comes to you in a different way?
Well, I think one can always get better at it. I think that some people have a more natural knack of having conversations. I mean, it's learning stories. It's learning about people. It's learning relationships and hearing their stories. It's providing a setting for discussing vulnerability or allowing vulnerability to be accessed. It's much easier to talk about maybe than to do. But that's what you try to do. Mm-hmm. That's what I try.
So one of the paradoxes of talking about compassionate care is that nobody wants to provide uncompassionate care, right? I mean, presumably. You can make jokes about different specialties, you know, that surgeons don't care about this or whatever, bone doctors, but presumably everyone wants to provide compassionate care in some sense. So what is it, how do you separate what is compassionate care and what's not?
I would hope that every encounter can have at least some. I mean, some encounters are clearly not as important as others. You know, a quick visit to urgent care may not sort of require as much of a connection. Although I think even in these smaller moments, a connection can be important. You know, whether it's just taking the moment to figure out what someone's interest is or what's important in their life, it takes a few seconds. And it can change the whole feeling of the conversation. So I think even when I expect an encounter to be brief, I try to sort of make contact somehow. Whether it's something physical, one of the biggest lessons I learned was actually from my own physician. In the time when I was hospitalized, and there were physician after physician coming in to sort of say everything's fine, yeah, you'll be going home today. And my primary care physician came and he sat down, you know? I mean, I think just the act of sitting down and being present. He didn't even have to say anything after that. I think that was the connection that I needed. You know, this was after having complications all night long, having your doctor just sit there and take the time. So I think compassionate care, you know, obviously there are bigger situations where, you know, longer term situations, more dire circumstances, more serious illness, where clearly compassionate care is, you know, always the goal. But I think even in the littlest encounters, we can try for a little bit of, you know, something.
What is it about pediatrics that offers a different way to be compassionate? Of course, we're talking about children and their families, but what does it make it more, does it make compassionate care more achievable when you're dealing with children? I've heard from many of the nurses and physical therapists and restoration therapists and others that they gave up on treating adults because they were a pain in the butt, and they went to go work with children because children had something. Maybe they're blameless, or maybe they're easier to care for in a certain way. Does that make it more possible to be compassionate, or does it complicate it, and in what ways?
The reason I can go to work every day is because I can always count on seeing a kid, seeing that face, whether it's this little or this big. Many of my patients are actually much taller than I am. So I think there's something special about taking care of kids. There's clearly, it's usually not something that you do wrong. usually not a bad habit that brought them to a hospital. So I think there is that sort of naiveness or innocence that sort of is special. But I think also, a kid usually comes with a family.
Right.
And unlike adult medicine, where all of your encounters or most of your interaction is with that adult patient generally, you're never only dealing with a patient in a pediatric setting. There's always someone else. There's always a family or community. And I think that's a great part of why I enjoy the work that I do.
How do you address, I want to circle back to a few different things. We'll come back to some other aspects of compassionate care, but sticking with the families and the fact of that families are usually, at best, at least the families are with the children and treating them. How do you deal with the religious and spiritual and multicultural complications that come with working with an entire family on life or death issues? Children's Hospital, for those of you who don't know, is a very international organization now. They have patients from all over the world. And I imagine beyond the languages, there's also values and special religious practices that come into play when you're talking about something as life-threatening and serious as the work that you do. What kinds of encounters have you had, and how do you adjust or adapt to that, to the dealing with the children and parents in that context?
Complicated question.
Of course. You're not getting paid for nothing.
Yeah. Where do I start? I think first you have to recognize, we have to recognize that everybody's different.
Yeah.
That, you know, for some people it's religion. For some people it's something that's not called religion, but something like religion. Or for some people it's something that definitely not like religion. Right? And so I think there are differences. And what patients think and what providers think. This is an old survey, but one survey I remember, almost 100%, like well into the high 90s of patients believe in God and have an important, find spirituality and religion an important part of their lives. And for medical professionals, it's a lot lower than that. And for mental health professionals, it's a lot lower than that. So, for many providers, I don't think it's in the radar. I don't think it's part of the approach. It's something that somebody else cares for. Hopefully I wasn't like that. But, I had an experience in 2002. Eventually, in the movie production, it was a fellowship that I did through the Schwartz Center. Anybody know about the Schwartz Center? Some of you probably do, but. So I did that fellowship in 2002, just 3 or 4 months after 9/11, and it was a several month fellowship. So the Schwartz Center is an entity that's right here in Boston. Kenneth Schwartz was a healthcare lawyer who at a relatively young age developed lung cancer without any sort of risk factors. I mean, he was a very health conscious guy and developed lung cancer and eventually died and was very moved and touched by the compassionate care that we received at Dana-Farber, I believe it was, or Mass General, anyway. But his family and his friends created the Schwartz Center after he died. The whole focus of the Schwartz Center is to support the idea of compassionate care through a lot of different avenues. One experience is this idea of Schwartz Center rounds where clinicians can come and meet once a month and talk about not just the medical aspects of a medical story, but the religious and spiritual aspects, the impact on us as persons. So it's really sort of they really support these efforts to support clinicians. So in 2002, I did a fellowship, and it was a all day Monday, 5 month experience. And for those of you who are familiar with chaplaincy training, basically it was a unit of CPE, or clinical pastoral education. So it was CPE, but this was a very special CPE unit, because none of us were planning to become chaplains per se. We were all medical professionals. So the class that Mass General, the CPE unit was for physicians and nurses and social workers. There was a pharmacist and a psychologist on my team, a respiratory therapist. And the idea was to sort of go through CPE training, but not with the intent to become a chaplain per se, but to learn some of the pastoral skills that chaplains use, but to use it in our own practice. So if we're nurses, our clinical experiences would be at the bedside. And for me, it was in the clinic and in the fetal diagnostic laboratory. And so we would take these experiences to our class every Monday. And for 5 months, we would sort of get better giving compassionate care. There was didactic stuff, so we learned about different traditions. So there was a different speaker every week to talk about Buddhist tradition, Islam, Jewish, Roman Catholic, and the whole line. But the whole idea was for us to learn techniques and language of chaplaincy, but to sort of apply it at the bedside or in the clinic. And that experience actually just changed my life, changed my practice. I mean, it was partially because it was right after 9/11. But I mean, it was, how often do you take that much time to sort of stop and think about what you're doing? And I had been in practice for about 10 years at that point, at Children's, and was sort of needing something else. And it really changed my life. I appreciate other people on the medical team, because it's clearly a team effort. I know that there are nursing students and social workers students here. It's all of us. It takes a village. It takes a huge community to care for the children and families of Boston Children. And this experience of CPE changed the way I practice.
Have you found that being able to be attentive to these non-medical needs, these non-physical needs, we'll say, of patients has helped the relationship more, or has the patient gotten better as a result of this? What can be some of the outcomes of a refreshed and more profound relationship with your patients and families?
I mean, I think it certainly helps to have a better understanding of where they're coming from. Part of CPE training was just learning what their belief system was, what's important in their lives. What are the practices that are important for them to sustain hope, even. So it gave me a different set of tools to. Help children and their families sort of sustain themselves, find hope. And I think the experience is more real the more you know about people. And I think it's not like I didn't do those kinds of things before, but it's almost like I got more permission to sort of talk. Just like it was on my list of questions. How is faith important to you? What does this all mean? Mm-hmm. What is your community of support? And what can I do? How should we modify our care to sort of help not only affect the medical goals but also the spiritual ones? I think that's the difference that the chaplaincy training gave me. It's sort of like, I can do this, And it's almost like I had achieved it. Because it's not really encouraged, it's not really talked about. in medical training. It's almost discouraged, actually. You know, this is something that the chaplain should do. This is something I socially should do, or, you know, no. So now I have the permission, or even the, you know, the desire, and I can recognize the value. I mean, I think parents and families want you. I mean, surveys show it. I mean, the parents, if you ask them, they want their physicians to address their spiritual needs. But if you ask them, has your doctor actually asked you about it? In the vast majority of cases, it's not. So I think understanding where they're coming from spiritually and religiously can help you, you know, find hope. You know, I mean, it's a different way of understanding, you know, other than the sort of the medical.
So on the flip side of that, how do you care for your own spiritual and religious needs in an environment that for many people would be overwhelming, for maybe reasons that are obvious to everyone here? How do you sustain yourself over a 30-year career to be a whole person when you leave and when you come every day?
Home life.
Yep.
I should check with my partner. That's very important. I think just being grounded. Exercise is important for me. I have a spiritual community. So I'm Roman Catholic, but also gay, and that introduces a completely different level of questioning and conflict. For me, it was Dignity, which is a community for Catholic GLBT people. And that's, I've been a member of Dignity since about 1990. That's my spiritual home, that's my spiritual family. That's very important. I'm a singer, I'm a musician, and the music I've been singing for the last 15 years has been all in the Renaissance, which is deeply spiritual and mostly religious, although not always.
We should put a link to your choir on our website, because they're magnificent, and they sing at churches around the metro area. Really, really.
It's Convivium Musicum.
Yes, it's not your weekend church choir. This is a high end group. So I can, that kind of practice that's required in mastery is spiritual in and of itself. I know. One last question before we turn out to the audience. Why is it that palliative care has been, or appears to be, marginalized from the core of medicine, and from maybe from nursing as well, and maybe from other practices, although it doesn't, seems to be less so from those other healthcare practices, when it seems to be so tightly wound together with the sort of hope and healing and vulnerability and spiritual practices that you're speaking of? Could you say a little bit about what palliative care is and what it could be and what it's not right now?
Yeah. So at Children's, palliative care, it's called the PAC team, Pediatric Advanced Care Team. I'm actually much more hopeful than you presented the question about the place of palliative care, at least in our hospital. You know, maybe most people think about palliative care as, you know, that what you do at the very end. So you live a long life, and then you know you're going to die, and then that's when you get the palliative care team. And it's almost as if when they call for the palliative care team, you kind of know, that's how you find out that, you know, it's not good. The approach at Children's has been very different, because I think that, first of all, a lot of studies show that involving palliative care earlier, sooner rather than later, actually makes people live longer. So it's not just about dying, but living, and I think the approach at Children's with the Pediatric Advanced Care Team is to involve them sooner and sooner, and even when there is no likelihood that a patient is actually going to die. But there are things that they address and handle much better than other physicians, like comfort. Spirituality, that I think the the move at Children's has been to bring palliative care. And part of, I think, the reason why they don't call themselves the palliative care team is so that, you know, when the team is called, it's not like, I'm not
the reaper.
Right. You know. So I think there's definitely huge value in palliative care, even in sort of the more traditional sense of palliative care in terms of making the best of a situation at the end of life. My own sister had family involved palliative care. So there's definitely value there, but I think that the movement is towards using the same sort of palliative technique earlier on in disease to improve life.
Well, I could do this all night, but there's you're an amazing audience with a lot of experiences and questions, I'm sure. And so I want to turn to open the conversation for the next half hour. So what questions do you bring or comments that you'd like to make on this that might get us started? And if you have an affiliation or such that might be relevant to the conversation, please let us know. Andrea.
Thank you very much for a very authentic presentation. Here in the audience, there are many students who are thinking about becoming physicians, others who are already studying nursing, others, as you said, who are engaged in social work. What would you like to tell them in light of your experience as a way for them to benefit from your experience, your wisdom, your personal engagement?
Two things, one maybe positive and one maybe a challenge. The careers that you have chosen or are choosing, amazing. I mean, even in the saddest of moments, even in the worst of medical circumstances, there is hope and resilience and just a lot of great qualities that you will find. And I think the careers in medical care, whether it be in medicine, nursing, social work, psychology, they're great fields. I'm worried that it's getting harder and harder for us to do this work authentically, given the regulations and the billing requirements and all that stuff. And do your best to fight that. And it's going to be your generation's responsibility to sort of reverse that trend. Because I think that over-regulation has made our lives as providers incredibly difficult, and I don't sort of put that out there to discourage you from the careers that you clearly feel called to do. But I do warn you that there are obstacles and barriers and sort of stuff that we need to fix to make our work easier and more effective. The requirements or stuff that we're required to do that just doesn't really make any sense. There's forms that we have to fill out, checks on the medical record. We have to do what's important for that family, for that child, for that encounter. And sometimes you kind of have to break the rules.
We'll blank that part out of the
No, I mean, I think, other experts in this there's just absolutely no way to do everything that you're supposed to do at every encounter. It's like, do you smoke? Do you feel safe at home? Are you in pain? It's like, maybe that's not what I need to do right now. Maybe today we just need to sit and talk about what this all means. So remember that that's important. And even if you have to somehow ignore the rules every now and then, that's what we're in this for. And that's what the families need.
Thank you. Yes.
Well,
we have a little microphone for you real quick to make sure we can hear you.
And I'm sorry that I gave you guys this side on the
side. Yeah, please,
sir. Hello, Dr. McCrow. First of all, thank you very much for coming. It's been a pleasure listening to you. So earlier on, you were saying that in like children's healthcare that you tend to see that parents want physicians to talk about faith or religion when dealing with care. My mother, she always told me that the biggest tests of faith are during times of harm. So I guess this question boils down to is, during your time as a physician, have there been any instances when you've seen patients or even patients' families starting, I guess, to lose faith, I guess, either religiously speaking or just in general?
Good question. Absolutely. And I think that illness is one of the biggest challenges of our faith. And that sort of how to deal with that question, it really varies in every context, you know, what, and that's why we need to be talking about these things. Because if we're not, you know, and a spiritual assessment can be as simple as what's your religion, right? And so often in the hospital, you know, somebody gets sort of tagged as ex-religion, whatever it is, like Catholic, whatever. And then certain assumptions get sort of tagged to that label, right? Which may not apply, right? So I think part of the work of spiritual assessment is sort of really trying to figure out what's important, not just what's your religion or even, you know, what your spirituality is, but what does this all mean to you? And how is this hard? And how can I help you? It's not going to be easy, right? And I think illness is one of the biggest challenges of faith. Right? If you think about it, why would God allow this? Right? And there are different ways of answering that question. But I guess my job, whether it's trying it myself or really getting a professional chaplain to do that, because it's a time of crisis and a challenge of faith. And ultimately, I think it is a search for hope. The way I like to frame things is not less so much on therapist as hope. How can we find hope in this situation? Okay? Even if it's fatal, right? I'm dying. But how can I be hopeful? And that's a difficult conversation to have, but it's one that we need to have. Is it trust in an afterlife? Is it satisfaction of a life well lived? And whatever it is, but having those conversations and you can sort of help the patient sort of overcome this sort of challenge, this spiritual crisis. Yeah, medical, every day we see spiritual. Small ones and huge ones. And if we as providers, at the nursing at the bedside or physicians, are not providing that care, then we need to access other professionals that can do that. This chaplain, you know, whatever the background of my patient is.
Yes, Susan.
I'm Susan
Janelle.
I'm the dean of the Cannell School of Nursing. And I will speak really loudly. So I was wondering if you were seeing changes, and if you were seeing changes, what they were. And you talked about comfort before, how we help provide comfort. Given all that we're seeing, hearing, and doing with the opioid crisis, has that made a difference in terms of providing comfort?
I mean, I think there are challenges in dealing with chronic pain, and the regulations and the difficulty with prescribing. If, you know, I don't have to. That's not part of my practice, largely. I mean, I think when it comes to end of life care, I don't think there's much conflict in terms of use of opioids for comfort. I think that the challenge is trying to find a balance of, you know, opioids and other sort of anti-pain regimens to manage chronic.
not always easy to get to Mo.
No, it's not.
That has been the challenge.
Right. That's the challenge to sort of, because everything and all the new laws and all the regulations are, you know, prescriptions have to be for only so many days, and it's harder and harder for physicians to manage that because it means it's more work. It means you have to rewrite the prescription. This means, you know, I mean, I think, you know, on the good side of that is, like, we are being encouraged to be more careful. But for families or patients who have chronic pain that need opioids, there needs to be access to those agents. But I personally am not involved in sort of chronic pain management.
Yeah.
Thank you.
My name is Jeff Bleckel. I teach in the philosophy department. I was happy or interested to hear the word vulnerability come up. Vulnerability of the person, the patient, of course, the vulnerability of the family around the patient. I wonder if you could say something about the vulnerability of the doctor, because you're talking about person-to-person caregiving. It seems to me that the doctor, as person caring for another person, has to contend with and maybe show some of his own vulnerability. So what do you think about that?
Yeah, I think I can't remember exactly now, but I think when I mentioned vulnerability, I was thinking about my own as well. It's vulnerability, but I think it's also a path to richness in the relationship. It's not universal by any means.
What's at risk when you're vulnerable with your patients? Families.
Well, I mean, I think most of it is training. I think most of us are just trained not to be open to share. It's not about us, right? It's not about me. But it's sort of hard to have a conversation about important things in life and not talk a little bit about yourself.
Right.
So it's not like I'm opening my heart up like I am today. when I'm you know, it really depends on the moment. But I think allowing, you know, I think maybe CPE helped me to sort of be aware of that and be open to some of that. I think the other opportunity that's lacking in the field is opportunities or places or community for us to be vulnerable together. I think that's one of the goals of Schwartz Center rounds. You know, these monthly rounds where people talk about a case, and I always get frustrated when it's all sort of medical, and I always want to say, well, what did it do to you? What were you thinking? You know, how hard is it for you? And that's so. I think there's really not enough opportunity for sharing vulnerability among us as professionals, because I think that's where it needs to happen first, you know. The CPE class that I started, that I took in 2002, we actually have an alumni group that meets the children's once a month and continues to meet since 2002. There's a core group of six or seven of us, and we get together at 7 a.m. on Wednesdays once a month. But that's where we can talk about it's among ourselves, and I think that we need more of that for everyone. You know, these are six people in a huge institution, right? I think everybody hopefully will find other opportunities, whether it's at home in their own family or within their spiritual community. I think for me, that small group and for professional stuff. For spiritual, religious, social justice stuff, it's my dignity community, my family, you know. But there has to be places to open up. Yes.
What role, if any, do religious leaders
compassion and healthcare, and enhancing his role of spirituality in healthcare. I ask this with experience around Catholic hospitals. My family's Catholic. In my parents' final multiple illnesses, they were in a Catholic hospital. And I've been thinking about that while you were talking. And my own experience is that we had some really wonderful experiences with a particular doctor and with his residents. They weren't overtly religious, but I'm wondering, do religiously affiliated hospitals, do you think they perhaps attract doctors who might have an interest in integrating their own spiritual beliefs with their practice of medicine? Or maybe it's maybe not at all.
Well, I can't really speak from direct experience because I've never practiced in any other hospital other than Children's, which is not affiliated with any faith community. We do have ecumenical chaplaincy service team with, and so we have access to all of the different religions. I mean, I would imagine that a physician might be attracted to a Catholic hospital if he were Catholic, but I'm not sure. Sorry, I can't really speak.
I understand, and I'm not sure either. As I said, the doctor we had, whom my mother adored, and who, as soon as I met him, I understood why, exuded the kind of serenity that seemed to come from some sort of inner peace or some kind of belief. He was an Indian man, and I don't know what his religion was. I really don't. But he had a very big impact on our family and his residents, so people he had trained. As my mother lay dying, we were out in the hall talking to one of his residents, and this guy happened to be Indian also, and I had no idea what his religion was, but he quoted, I think it's Ecclesiastes, what's the one, there's a time for everything, a time to be born and a time to die. But he quoted it in such a way that it was as natural as if he had told us what time it was. We were trying to figure out, when is she going to die, how will we know? And he answered it in such a peaceful, wonderful way, and the way he said that, it was just very comforting. So we had really good experiences. I'm not sure if it was directly tied to the fact that it was
It sounds like a beautiful experience, and I think that should be the goal for all of us, right?
Yeah.
No matter what my tradition is or what yours is, we can have an interaction that sort of brings comfort and helps, you know, find peace. And that was, again, you know, part of the TBE training is to sort of, you know, forget about what the name is, but to be able to serve all, or at least most. And it sounds like you really had a great team there.
In your training and in these conversations professionally, do you speak of a language of accompaniment or being with someone? This is a language that's sometimes used in theological circles. And how does that relate, if so, how does that relate to the expectations that probably patients put onto you more than, or parents put onto you more than you put on yourself, but the sort of feeling that you should be omniscient around things. There's a tension there around just being with someone and seeing where this is going versus telling them what it looks like from 30,000 feet or from the perspective of someone who's seen this before, you know. How do you manage that attention?
I don't know if this directly addresses your question, but I see my work as journeys with, I've been in practice long enough that I have patients now who were prenatally diagnosed. So these are families where I diagnosed their child with heart disease before they were even born, and now they're graduating from college. And for me, that's just the amazing thing, to sort of have the journey of having to tell this, you know, sort of pregnant couple that their child is going to have this very serious heart defect and require a major operation in the newborn period. And then in this particular family, I'm remembering sort of standing at the bedside as the baby was being baptized, and they still sort of see me as honorary godfather. And every year I see her, this one's 14 now. So it's an experience of journey, and it's the privilege of being able to, you know, follow along and join in the trip, and whether there's like good time or bad time, we're in this together. Yeah. It's powerful.
Yes.
Hi, I'm a student here and currently doing a thesis research on experiences of Muslim refugees in the U.S. healthcare system and Western countries as well. So my question is, a lot of Muslim refugees more recently, when they come here, report being discouraged by our healthcare system because they're constantly bouncing provider to provider and having to re-explain their situation, and also just a general lack of interest in the providers engaging with their patients. So my question is, how do we even begin to have compassionate healthcare and conversations about religion when patients are kind of constantly going from one provider to a specialist to another specialist?
Yeah, definitely a challenge. I mean, I can only speak from my experience. We have a lot of Muslim patients at Children's. I mean, on any given day, you walk through the lobby, and I hope that that's not the experience that they have where we are. But I think we do have to find a better way to sort of develop journeys, you know, and establish relationships. And it's not, you know, obviously not just reserved to Muslim immigrants. I mean, there are other immigrants from other parts of the country. And I worry a lot about immigrants currently, as a grandson of immigrant grandparents, you know. And I worry a lot also about the bigger issue of access to healthcare in general, whether you are immigrant or American without means, you know. And I think we have to do better at providing good healthcare for everyone. And that's my pitch for universal healthcare. You can put that in or not, but I think there are major weaknesses. I mean, here we are, United States of America, and there are things in our medical care system that I'm not proud of, and we could change that. But I think, you know, the situation that you bring up is part of that. You know, being able to provide for all, having, you know, I mean, we have the luxury at Children's to have interpreters for just about any language, and if for the ones that we don't have in house, we can, you know, get on an iPad and actually have a conversation, or at least a phone conversation at any hour. And that, you know, we need to be able to provide that to everyone.
Can you say a word about the roles that the different people play that you work with? You mentioned how important, no, let me rephrase it. You mentioned that every interaction is a team effort to care for a patient in the line of work that you do. What can you say about how that team works to provide compassionate care? Is there an emphasis, or are some institutionally inclined to provide a different kind of care? And how do you manage that work to provide the best thing and not be at cross purposes with all the different kinds of people that you work with there?
Yeah. I mean, first of all, we need to recognize that as physicians, we spend a very short period of time with that patient and family in the hospital, you know, when they're in the hospital. And it's really the nurses and other healthcare professionals that are running around the bedside that spend the whole day. So any important discussion at Children's for a seriously ill patient, especially in the ICU or even not in the ICU, needs to involve all of the caretakers, especially nurses. They're there 24 hours a day. And they hear all the stories, and they meet every, they meet more people. I mean, because all the visitors come in, the families, so they have a, I think, on average, I think, a much broader appreciation of what that family unit is really like. So they're a huge part of any sort of big decision or management plan.
Good. Any other questions before we wrap up for this evening? Oh, good, okay.
Hi, I'm an adult Jero NP student here. And you mentioned that you think that spirituality is somewhat discouraged in medical school training. And I'm just wondering, do you think this speaks to a larger societal issue where we're uncomfortable speaking about this, similar to the taboo of speaking about death with one another?
Can I ask you a question first? How much spiritual care training do you get in your nursing program?
Not a lot.
Yeah. So I think it's a big limitation to the training of physicians. I think it's getting better. I think people are recognizing there's more publications about the importance of religion, spirituality. But it needs to be part of training. So who here can change the curriculum?
But for our palliative care program, and we have a lot of courses that we hope you are taking so that you can answer.
I am in this.
But
for everyone, if you're not pursuing that.
Oh, but he asked you.
Right.
And your question is, you're getting quite a lot.
No, but I think it's something that not people who are going to specialize in palliative care should have some access to. And so hopefully, as students in training sort of recognize the importance of that and start taking these classes, which I think are becoming more available. But it's not sort of, you know, oftentimes it's a elective or, you know, and maybe it should become more of a required curriculum. That's just my opinion.
Yes, sir, we had one more question for someone. No, ma'am. Sorry, yes.
I'm a retired nurse, but I had worked in critical care.
Could you use
the
microphone so we can hear you?
Years. Oh, I'm a retired nurse, but I had worked in critical care in the emergency room for many years. Did my training in a 3-year program at a Catholic institution, and it was a privilege working in the Catholic hospital. I saw a huge difference between working in a Catholic hospital and a secular hospital over the years. Two things in my career that I want to share with you. As far as team members, I can't stress enough the importance of the housekeeping department. They are with the patient every day, every week. They're cleaning that room. They're non-judgmental, and they bring back such profound information to the staff. And I think they need to be recognized as part of that team. And when they say something to you, you listen and you act on it. And the other thing, within an institution, if you're getting the last rites, to invite everyone within that department together.
Thank you very much. Is there one more? Yeah, okay.
Hi, I'm Bridget. I'm a student in the nursing school. I had a few questions, actually. My first question is, were you chosen for the chaplaincy fellowship, or did you have to apply for that?
I applied, yeah.
My other question is, do you think your sexuality makes you a more compassionate healthcare provider?
More than?
Being like a minority.
I mean, I think, wow.
Was like the last few minutes in your
No, I totally respect the question. I certainly think it's a big part of who I am, and I think that the discernment and struggle even, and sort of finding a place and being able to integrate that as a major part of my life makes me a better person, and hopefully that shows in the care that I provide. I think that's how I would answer that.
Well, Ron, this has been magnificent. Thank you so much for taking the time out of your day to be here and for opening yourself up to us. It's not the usual lecture on cardiovascular disease. And it's probably a lot harder than that for you. I appreciate your willingness to be here. And thank you all for being a part of it.